Oh, hell no. It's HyperZone on Super NES Works. Back at the first year of the Super NES's life in the US market. It was the 90s, and while there may not actually have been time for clacks, despite Atari's bold claims otherwise, there definitely was time for shoot-em-ups. In fact, for this first while, shooters will be to the Super NES what box puzzlers are to Game Boy, the ubiquitous filler content from which there is no escape. Fully 1 out of 5 Super NES titles released in 1991 falls comfortably into the shooter genre. More if you count the chopper missions from Pilot Wings and consider Paperboy 2 a shooter, which it kind of is and kind of isn't. The only genre that matches the shooter in sheer proliferation is the platformer, and even then, the shooter wins out, because ActRaiser is only like 50% platformer. People just really liked the idea of tiny spaceships spewing screens full of hot plasma death against grotesque alien abominations during that handful of years in which George Bush was too busy running the country to find time to squeeze women's butts, I guess. We're on episode 9 of Super NES Works, and already we've hit our third entry in the genre. So it's something of a relief that this one breaks from the standard template of the times. HAL's HyperZone belongs neither to the Star Soldier-style vertical shooter family, nor to the Gradius-derived horizontal group. Rather, it falls into the relatively scarce forward-scrolling shooter, one for which the Super NES hardware, of course, was particularly well-suited. We've seen the graphical scaling and perspective features Nintendo built into the hardware in F-Zero and Pilot Wings, though weirdly not in Draken, and HyperZone is pretty much F-Zero, the shooting. Indeed, you'd be forgiven for mistaking HyperZone for some sort of F-Zero clone or knockoff at first glance. The two games have a profoundly similar visual style as players control a small futuristic ship across a constantly scrolling landscape that consists of a bitmap graphic pitched forward and given a vanishing point. Given the close relationship between HAL and Nintendo, that probably wasn't a coincidence. I can't find any developer interviews or insider information online regarding this long-forgotten blip on the Super NES radar, but HyperZone showed up a mere 9 months after F-Zero's debut in Japan. Not really enough time for HAL's designers to play Nintendo's racer and build a game from scratch. Or is it? HyperZone includes some weirdly obsessive details, including a new heads-up display style every time you upgrade your ship, but as a game experience, it feels decidedly slight. HyperZone drops players into a high-speed attack craft streaking through kinda 3D landscapes, and it arms them with a paltry selection of capabilities. You can move freely around the screen, fire into the distance, and not really much more. Your ship has the ability to break, but if you slow down too much, you'll take damage, and once you upgrade beyond the initial fighter craft, you'll gain a handy charge shot that allows you to hit enemies for extra damage. Other than that, though, you can forget about any sort of power-up scheme or anything else of actual substance. Enemies streak past at high speeds, never appearing on screen long enough to demonstrate any sort of interesting patterns or tactics. Basically, the game throws a lot of stuff at you and simply tries to overwhelm you with volume and the ambiguity of a fake 3D perspective. Lacking proper polygonal graphical elements, HyperZone relies on scaling sprites reminiscent of Sega's Superscalar arcade games. And while the Super NES hardware manages to pull off this flashy forward-scrolling effect with far more grace and far less slowdown than we've seen so far in the system's vertical shooters, this is definitely no Galaxy Force 2. The F-Zero connection certainly seems profound, including the way you pass over glowing zones to recharge your ship's shields. It gets to the point that you can't help but wonder if HyperZone was originally maybe designed to be a racing game that hastily changed tracks to avoid overlapping too much with Nintendo's entry into the genre. Whatever the case, HyperZone does at least add a novel trick to F-Zero's bag of tricks by mirroring the racetrack to the ceiling, creating a sort of sandwiched effect. Due to the limitations of Mode 7, the ceiling of the track simply reflects the ground, but it's still a pretty neat effect, although the vibrant, high-contrast color design at play here does make for a severe eyesore at full speed. The Super NES's scaling and rotation effects certainly looked cool, but as we'll see throughout this video series, they could only create flat illusions, meaning HyperZone doesn't even come close to matching the more immersive visuals of something based in polygons like StunRunner. A closer analog would be Space Harrier, a comparison that becomes a lot more obvious once you reach the game's first boss. That's a dragon built of overlapping sprites that flies into and out from the screen, and it's straight from the Space Harrier playbook. Of course, this is no Sega game, and HyperZone is happy to remind you of that fact. The second boss is, in fact, a Super Famicom controller, and its buttons fire color-coded rings at you. That's a fun idea, although its impact is somewhat diminished in the US thanks to HAL's failure to tweak the boss's color scheme to match the US's controllers. It's also no Sega game in the lack of variety on display. HyperZone becomes quite repetitive quite quickly. Again, lacking the constant stream of fresh challenges seen in something like Galaxy Force 3 years earlier. HyperZone creates challenge by restricting players to extremely cramped spaces. If you drift from beyond the center pathway, your ship will slow down and take damage, and filling those narrow passages with enemies and projectiles. You'll eventually learn the rhythms of evasion, which makes things easier, but as with Super R-Type, HyperZone doesn't really have a lot of content to offer, so it doesn't give you the option to continue, and it throws an almost impossible amount of cheap obstacles at you. Pillars of fire and electrical beams might actually be the deadliest threat in HyperZone simply because it's so hard to judge their relative distance to your ship. They tend to appear in rapid succession, forcing you to weave between them with flawless timing. And if you bungle that timing, you'll take multiple consecutive hits, bringing your mission to a rapid end. It seems likely that HAL didn't intend for HyperZone's spatial depth to be quite so difficult to parse. The game contains a hidden code that allows you to activate an active shutter 3D mode, which causes the graphics to alternate positions on alternating frames to create a stereoscopic 3D effect. No one ever shipped 3D glasses for the Super NES though, so this feature remained somewhat useless. There's no indication of whether HyperZone's 3D feature was added to take advantage of a planned peripheral that ended up being scrapped, or if HAL was simply future-proofing the game in the event something like that ever came along. Nintendo's previous console, the Japanese Famicom, did of course receive an active shutter 3D glasses peripheral. So the idea that its follow-up console would also be graced with 3D stereoscopic capabilities wasn't too far-fetched. And in fact, two of HyperZone's programmers, Hiroaki Suga and Miya Aoki, had first-hand experience developing for the Famicom 3D glasses. They were the programming leads on Famicom Grand Prix 2 3D Hot Rally, Nintendo's own entry into the 3D racing space. This is all just trivia, though. HyperZone turns out to be a decent, if extremely one-note shooter with a graphical effect that wobbles on the knife edge between impressive and skull-splitting. Again, the most interesting thing about the game is its HUD, which changes every time your little fighter pilot upgrades his ship. Skin changes were a pretty fresh user interface concept in 1991, so HAL was a little bit ahead of its time here. And it's such a peculiar, needless little touch. It really suggests the team had a lot of passion for this game, and it makes you wonder if HyperZone could have been something truly special with a little more time in the oven. Unfortunately, HyperZone falls right into the darkest times in the history of HAL Laboratories. The company nearly fell into bankruptcy in the early 90s, only to be saved by some smart choices by newly elevated boss Satoru Iwata and the popularity of the Kirby series, which was created by many of the people who worked on HyperZone. HAL pulled itself out of its tailspin before going out of business, but you'll get the impression from the company's early Super NES era releases that it was spitballing rapidly in order to save its bacon by any means possible. HyperZone definitely feels like a casualty of those financial straits, and as such, it's gone down in history as nothing more than a mere blip or curiosity. Still, it's not a bad game at all, just extremely limited. If you can find a copy for a few bucks, it might be worth a look. And hey, if you have some 3D shutter specs left over from the electronic industry's recent belly flop into 3D TVs, you might even be able to get them working with the hidden 3D mode to experience HyperZone the way its creators truly intended. HyperZone isn't quite a hidden gem of the Super NES library, but at the very least, it's a little-known semi-precious stone. The Chalcedony of 16-bit racers. Next on Super NES Works, HyperZone was blazing fast, and now we dial down the speed to the other extreme.